Well, good evening, Mr. President, Excellencies, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. As you have seen, our president is always working, he never sleeps. So he is a good example for us, the young people in government, how to handle things. And because of that, I am also the Minister of Development and Defense. But ladies and gentlemen, it gives me a great pleasure to address this special event, Singapore Forum on the Arctic, an addition to the recent annual Arctic Circle Assembly in Reykjavik, convened by the Arctic Circle and Singapore Maritime Institute here with the support of the Singapore government. The government of Iceland has identified developments in the Arctic and Iceland's role in both managing and protecting it as one of the top priorities of our foreign policy. There is a broad acceptance, even consensus, across the political spectrum in the Parliament when it comes to the Arctic. And after assuming my position as a Minister for Foreign Affairs of Iceland in 2013, I have devoted considerable time and effort in Arctic affairs. I also have to thank that to Mr. President. It is a subject that is highly important in so many ways. As an Arctic coastal state and a founding member of the Arctic Council, Iceland has a great interest and stake in the Arctic. Shaped strongly by its geographical position and access to natural resources and its utilization, Iceland's Arctic policy emphasizes that the key to success is through international cooperation, whether dealing with the many risks associated with the changing Arctic or the various new economic opportunities. The significance of the Arctic on the international arena has increased substantially in recent years by virtue of climate change. While the causes of climate change are global, the effects are most rapid and visible in the Arctic. These changes are occurring at an even faster pace than anticipated. They are multifaceted and affect our societies in various ways, economically, socially, environmentally, culturally, and in terms of security. Discussions have brought our attention to many important issues facing the Arctic today and how many of the challenges can only be addressed through cooperation at the national, regional, and international levels. Ladies and gentlemen, looking ahead, the future of Arctic cooperation is bright. We have a well-structured and sound regional cooperation in the Arctic Council, where our partners from outside the Arctic, including Singapore, have a clear voice. The Council celebrates 20th anniversary next year. It's maturing and developing with the necessary self-confidence and stimulate global approach to the most urgent problems in the region and to build bridges of cooperation to outside stakeholders. Iceland is committed to strengthen its work, both within the Arctic and globally, to address the environmental challenges facing the region, but also to find necessary balance between conservation and utilization. The people of the Arctic and their societies must be able to benefit from economic activities, while sustainability and sound management of resources remain central to our considerations and policymaking. The growing international significance of the Council is also underlined by the fact that it is now includes 10 out of the 11 largest economies as members or as an observer, 6 out of the 15 largest oil-producing countries and 9 out of the 20 largest fishing nations in the world. The interest of powerhouses such as China, India, Japan, Korea, which all have been granted an observer status in recent years, should not be seen as a threat to Arctic cooperation, but as an acknowledgement of our successes. Also, for the observer states, it should be considered a privilege to be granted such a status, and matched by responsibility, the observer states need to demonstrate in a visible and concrete manner that they have contributors to the welfare of the Arctic. In my view, the observers are rising to the occasion and showing good willingness and ability to do exactly that. Ladies and gentlemen, everywhere we are witnessing the consequences of climate change, but its impact is particularly revealing and drastic in the Arctic. Temperatures in the Arctic are increasing at more than twice the average global rate. The fragile ecosystem of the region is increasingly at risk, and Arctic communities are experiencing first-hand the challenges of dealing with the rapidly changing climate. And the consequences are far-reaching, and there are repercussions around the world. Our understanding of climate change advances every day. We know that human activity is changing the climate. With the release of vast quantities of carbon dioxide into the atmosphere, where it stays for centuries or longer with warming effects. Carbon dioxide also leads to ocean acidification. Therefore, actions to reduce emissions of carbon dioxide is an essential backbone of any climate mitigation strategy. We can and we should have a constructive debate about how we are going to address this imminent problem, and I believe there is still time to turn things around. That can only be done through adaptation and cooperation. COP21 in Paris next month will be our chance, maybe the last chance, to put us on track towards a sustainable future. At the recent Glacier Conference in Alaska, the Arctic states recognized their leadership role in providing for sustainable development and cooperation in the Arctic, and reaffirmed the commitment to take actions to slow down the pace of warming in the Arctic. One important result of the conference was the willingness of observer states of the Arctic Council and the European Union to join forces with us in this endeavor. At the regional level, the Arctic Council, supported by a number of observer states, is taking the lead in addressing emissions of short-lived climate pollutants that pose a particular threat to the melting ice on the top of the world. Those efforts can become one significant element of our fight against climate change, as policy actions could provide climate mitigation benefits in the short term, slowing the rate of warming and its consequences impacts over the next decades. It is a fact that the Arctic Council states and the observer states account for the bulk of short-lived climate pollutants. It is also a fact, a sad fact, that subsidies in the sectors of fossil fuels amount to some $14.5 billion every day. Imagine the result if we could only channel a portion of these amounts towards renewable energy resources. We need to direct more financing towards the climate, and Iceland will in the next 5 years contribute more than $1 million to the Green Climate Fund, which I had the privilege of visiting during my visit to Korea earlier this week. And ladies and gentlemen, the Arctic Council is open to observers who can contribute to the work of the Council. And in this context, I appreciate Singapore's strong commitment, contribution, and engagement on Arctic affairs and the work of the Council, and also welcome the ties between two good countries, ties that we have been able to enhance and deepen in many spheres, in spite of the vast distances between us on the world map. Since submitting its application and becoming an observer, Singapore has made efforts to increase its engagement with the Arctic states, permanent participants and Arctic communities, as well as other stakeholders. Based on my visit here and discussions, it is clear that there are ample opportunities for further collaboration. Singapore has extensive experience as a center of excellence in marine and offshore engineering research, which could contribute to the development of new Arctic shipping routes. There are also opportunities in areas such as icebreaker development, maritime technology, and offshore rig construction, in which Singapore has significant capabilities. Stronger cooperation can reinforce our ability to meet the challenges and opportunities we face locally, regionally, and internationally. Distinguished guests, let me conclude by saying that we should build on our experience in using the Arctic Council as a bridge to link the Arctic in a constructive way to the international community, including non-Arctic states, international businesses, and other stakeholders. And dear friends, I applaud President Grimson for his engagement and vision in the Arctic. Were it not for him, there would be no Arctic Circle Assembly. The Assembly plays an important role here in increasing the participation in Arctic dialogue and strengthening the international focus on the future of the Arctic. Iceland will continue to engage in the momentous work and collaboration on Arctic issues. wherever and whenever possible, including cooperation here with Singapore. A prosperous future for our magnificent Arctic can best be secured through inclusive and many-sided cooperation at all levels. We need good information and good judgment to chart the road to success and sustainability. There is no reason, ladies and gentlemen, to wait for the future in this respect. I know it is a cliché, but when it comes to the Arctic, it is true, the future is now. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Minister Simonsen. Please continue to enjoy your dinner.